This episode of the MMA Complex podcast is brought to you by HollowRockGear.com.
Go to HollowRockGear.com, register at the site, and use the promo code COMPLEX15 to get 15% off your order. It is some of the best sports apparel money can buy. Again, go to HollowRockGear.com.
Welcome to another edition of the MMA Complex. My name is James.
And my name is Josh.
And today is a very special day. Today is 1 year since the birth of the MMA Complex. So happy anniversary to the MMA Complex. Woo! Yes, I know. It's kind of crazy that it's been a year, man. Yeah. Does it feel like a year to you, or?
It does, but it's been a fun year, man. Yeah. We've done a lot of stuff. We've come a long way in a year, man.
I feel like I'm aging the year.
Yeah.
Oh, I have, but.
Yeah. We'll do another anniversary for like the 100th episode.
Yeah.
It's
a year.
Our year anniversary, a year just around this time.
And we knew it was going to be, a year. So we try to stack the deck in today's episode. On today's episode, we have the producer of the MMA Hour, Eric Jackman, aka New York Rick. He'll be on the show to discuss Glory 33 and Invicta 19 coming up this month. And we also have the founder of the 10 Planet Jiu-Jitsu System, Mr. Eddie Bravo, as he talks about EBI number 8.
This weekend.
That happens September 11th at the Open Theater in downtown Los Angeles. And with Glory Heavyweight, Chi Lewis-Parry, as he prepares for his heavyweight bout for Glory 33, that goes down September 9th, streaming on UFC Fight Pass for the prelims and ESPN2 for the main card. So lots of guests to discuss. This past weekend, we also had UFC Germany with Andre Arlovski facing Josh Barnett in a very important fight in the heavyweight division. And did you watch the fights? And if you did, pick one fight to kind of highlight it for you for the weekend.
You know, I didn't watch the fights.
Not me neither.
I saw the highlights and I caught the fights later on.
Yeah.
You know what I was watching was the Rogan's. Fight companion. Yeah, I was watching Rogan's Fight Companion. Yeah. And I was doing some work in between that time because I didn't have Fight Pass anymore. I don't have it anymore. You know, so there's not that many fights that we have to need it.
If you have any fans out there that like our show, you know, give us a password to use. Hook us up.
I don't know. We just haven't. We had it for a while.
Yeah.
I think just a couple of months ago, I think we got rid of it. I don't know. Yeah. We're like watching it together. Yeah. So,
are subscribers of the WD Network. So
yeah, we do have that. I didn't catch them as they aired, but I caught them later on while they're airing. I watched the Rogan show, which was always hilarious and that was it. I mean, the fights were. I mean, what a war that the Arlovski and Barnett though.
Yeah.
Man, that was each one looked like they were going to go out at some point. They were knocking each other down repeatedly. What'd you think?
Yeah, no, I agree, man. That the main event was pretty epic. I thought for sure Barnett was going to get stopped at some point of that fight.
Yeah,
but kudos to Barnett, man. He came back. He showed heart. He didn't give up, and he ended up stopping Arlovski with a choke, I believe.
Yeah, rear naked.
Yeah, so that was an impressive win for him. A much needed win for Barnett, and also that another fight that kind of highlighted the weekend was obviously the knockout by one Ryan Bader.
Dude, that was crazy.
I mean, I think everyone expected it to be a win for the Tiffy.
Yeah, but just because I don't know. It's just you felt like the Tiffy was more on the rise.
Yeah. He's a bigger guy.
And he's so,
strong wrestler as well.
Strong wrestler. He's, he's got heavy hands. He's a big guy. But he was, telegraphing his punches a lot. And I think Bader just caught him a few times with that incoming knee. And then, I think he caught him with, a head kick, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or I think it was a knee, wasn't it?
Was it a knee?
A knee, yeah. It was a knee.
It was a leg. I don't know if his leg was fully extended.
Maybe it wasn't.
But, man, Latifi just flew back. And
yeah.
You heard the thud when he hit.
Concussion, man.
Yeah, you heard the thud when he hit. And,
yeah.
I mean, it was a big win for Bader.
He needed it as well, man.
Yeah.
He needed that win.
It keeps him in the top 5, top 10.
Yeah.
I don't know where he goes from here. You could rematch John Jones when he comes back. Because most likely Johnson will probably fight Cormier.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like Jones might return before that or around that time. just hook him up a Bader. Or Bader could fight OSP or... I don't know. I don't know if OSP is free right now.
Yeah, that 205 division is a weird one for sure.
Yeah.
But other than the weekend, did you do anything else this past weekend?
Well, speaking of Rogan and them, they had a show at the Comedy Store.
Mm-hmm.
Check that out. Joey Diaz was there. Anthony Jeselnik. Who else? A few others. That was a sick lineup, so I went to check that out. That's always a good time. But, yeah, I mean, other than the fights, I mean, that was pretty much what I did. It was a good weekend, though. What did you like about the fights overall, though? Or which one stood out to you? Which fight?
The main event, just because it was a back-and-forth war. The fact that Barnett was very close to getting stopped in that, and I think the second or third round, and the fact that he came back and won the fight. But I was supposed to go to that show with you, man, but I was dying in bed.
Yeah, you were sick. Like,
yeah, I had a hard time getting up, going to the bathroom, was how bad it was. But
what did you eat?
I didn't. You know, there's times where I wake up in the middle of the night, I'm half asleep, and I just eat.
Yeah.
I must have ate something bad. I think there was leftovers that weren't put away.
Yeah.
And I didn't think it was a big deal. And I ate it. And I paid for my sins. But in a way, it was cool, man, because I got to stay in bed and watch Narcos Season 2. So it was a good time, man.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I mean, lots of things happened this past week besides the fights and a lot of news coming out of this week. I think the biggest news or the biggest storyline coming out of the weekend is... you know, Joe Silva, the matchmaker for the UFC, making an announcement saying that he's going to leave the UFC by the end of the year.
Yes.
Your thoughts on that, and do you think that it's because of the new ownership of the UFC?
I think so. It's the perfect time to get out. Everybody else is. You know? I think he's been planning this for a while. Yeah. From what I hear, people have been talking about him wanting to retire at some point. For a while now, and you know, he's been there since even before Dana White and all Fertitta took over.
Yeah.
So he's been there since like 95. And he's, dude, we everything we've seen has been like a Joe Silva show. So it's weird to see him go. I didn't think he would ever leave.
Yeah.
At least not that this soon. You know, he was a key central figure.
Yeah.
That I don't even know if the WME guys were really
expecting,
you know, or like really put too much thought in.
I wonder if those guys were still by the company, knowing if they knew beforehand the losses that would come out of their staff, if they would still, you know, purchase the UFC, because you know, Joe Silva was a very important aspect of the UFC team. A guy that not only does matchmaking, but he also has to come up with new matches if a fight falls out. So he's a very important key.
Yeah.
And it's crazy how he even got into the business. I think he wrote an ad in the Black Belt magazine.
Yeah, there was an ad for a matchmaker, and I think Campbell.
Combate CEO.
CEO answered it, who was one of the UFC heads at the time. And he pulled him in and called him in.
That's crazy. Because now, like, I think, like, you need to have some kind of experience, kind of, right?
Yeah.
Like, because you need to get the job now.
No, they can't do that. Those days are long gone. I mean, unless you go for a small little promotion, maybe you can find something, but even then.
But do you think it's going to impact the UFC? Like, do you think we'll see
fall
in matches?
It's a big loss. I don't know if WME and IMG were really focusing so much on Joe Silva when they should have, and they were just focusing on
locked him in.
They were just focusing on getting Dana.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I don't know how much of an impact it's gonna. We have to see. You saw Sean Shelby there.
Yeah.
Who was a big central focus because he was covering the lighter weights from 55 under. Joe Silva took the higher weights, and I don't know. I mean, obviously Sean Shelby, as far as we know right now, is still on board. They could bring somebody else in that's credible from another organization.
Yeah.
It's not like it's going to be
that
hard to, you know, obviously it's not an easy job.
Not only that, but you know, Joe Silva already established a relationship with the fighters. I think it's a very intimidating job, you know, having them discipline, not just from the fighters, but kind of like negotiate and try to, you know, bring in fights.
Yeah.
And like, you have to be a hard-nosed kind of guy to have that job. And the fact that he's gone now, having a new guy come in, these fighters can kind of, you know, easily walk over whoever they hire. I think right now maybe Sean Shelby could do the whole roster. I think that's a lot to do.
That's a lot, man.
But maybe, or maybe just do the higher weight class and then have someone else. Or I don't know. It's a tricky thing, only because, you know, Sean already had that establishment with the girls and the lighter weight classes. So
I think they,
who knows?
I think they'll bring somebody in who's credible, has experience, who's probably from another big promotion that's used to dealing with it.
Yeah,
there's not a whole lot of them out there. But I think they're going to be able to find somebody, and we'll see what happens from then on out. I think it should be, as long as Sean Shelby's there, Dana's there, it should almost feel like the same type of thing, and we should probably get the same matchups we usually get.
Do you think it's going to be like a domino effect? You know, we'll see more people leaving this year or next?
Like key central roles? I mean, it doesn't really get any bigger than that. You got Dana, you got Fertitas, you got, Joe Silva and the matchmakers, everybody else. Obviously, they're big players, all the other execs. Like, you got the foreign executives that are heading over those markets, but even then, they're not really in the limelight, so we don't see them too much.
I think...
It doesn't get any bigger than Joe Silva and
Dana. You're right. I think fans are kind of freaking out over this, and I think that this could be the end of the UFC, but I don't think that's true. I think the UFC training rolls on, and there's plenty of credible matchmakers they can pick up, so I'm not too worried about it.
No.
So, just got to see what happens. But let's get to our first interview.
Yeah, we have a big show for you guys this week, man.
So get a beverage and relax and watch all the news we have today. So, we'll start with New York Rick. He's obviously the producer of the MMA Hour. You can catch every Mondays, 10 a.m. Pacific Time and 1 p.m. Eastern Time. On the MMAfighting.com's YouTube page. So here's our interview with New York Rick.
What's up, man? Yes.
What's up, man?
What's up, boys? See that? Beautiful New York City day.
Yeah. I miss New York, man. It's been a while. Well, Josh was there not so long ago.
Is it?
Oh, I was there last year. How's
that? Is it too loud?
No, you're good, man. You're good. No, it's good seeing you. Haven't seen you in a while, man.
Likewise, boys. It's nice right now. It's really nice. Weather is good.
Yeah, how do you get the Wi-Fi out there?
You can't beat that, right?
No, not at all. You're playing ball? Who are you playing ball with?
I got that strong
connect.
Internet. Those are my two boys down there.
Okay.
Wait, is that the league you play for? The basketball league that you play with, or?
Not for this.
Oh, okay.
That's during the week.
Yeah.
And that's for like with Ariel, right? It's you, Ariel, and some other guys. There you are.
I'm trying to move to a better spot. I heard you guys said something about Benson fight week.
Yeah, I spoke to him, and he said that pretty much Ariel ducked him. I guess Benson was in New York recently.
Yes. Yeah, no, Benson did the show. He came into the studio.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And he said that he ducked him, and Ariel ducked him for a one-on-one game.
You'd think I'd know better than this to do an interview outside, but I was just playing ball longer than I thought. Trying to move to a spot where it's not so bright. So that doesn't look crazy.
God.
Wait, this might be the winner. Ah, there we go.
Glory 33 is coming up. New Jersey, September 9th. Talk to us about that. There's two awesome title fights with... Sorry, Marcus defending his middleweight championship, and obviously Van Hooven. Your thoughts on the card, and are you excited that it's in in the New York area?
Yeah. So, first of all, two title fights. Simon Marcus, who might be the best, pound-for-pound striker on the planet.
Yeah,
up agree. There with the likes of Rico Verhoeven himself, and who's also on the card. And, up there with some of the other Glory champions. Nicky Holskin, up there with some of the really, really best. Simon Marcus has been through the ringer, proven himself as one of the best strikers on the planet, defending his title against Jason Wellness, who, is still super young. People forget Jason Wellness is only like 26 years old, I think. Mm-hmm. He's been around so long. People think of him as a veteran from the Dutch kickboxing background. But the guy is only 26, and he's just, getting to the precipice of where he could be. It's going to be a great fight. Then you've got Rico headlining the event against Anderson Silva. Obviously Rico, people know that Rico is scheduled to fight Badr Hari in December.
Yeah.
It's no secret that was announced. And then the fight with Anderson Silva was announced. So the thought could be, is he taking Anderson Silva lightly? I've spoken to Rico. You know, he's actually here now. He's in New Jersey right now getting ready for the fight. So he's not taking any chances. He's not flying in, you know, fight week late and trying to, you know, take it easy and get it done. He is preparing for this like every other title fight that he has. And if you know anything about Rico Verhoeven, preparation is not a problem for him. Yeah, that's the one thing you know. He's going to be prepared to go in for 5 hard rounds, and he is going to do that if need be on Friday night. And at the same time, Anderson Silva is no slouch. This guy has been around forever.
Yeah.
You know, just like a Jason Wilmes, this guy has been making his bones in, you know, the top echelon of kickboxing for a long, long time.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people are excited for him to finally get that title shot. It's been a long time coming. And I love this matchup. I love this card. There's also, you know, the one-night tournament that Glory's known for.
Yeah.
There's also the continuation of the women's super bantamweight tournament. There's also some other great fights on the Super Fight Series. Top to bottom, it's a really good night. And if you're in the area and you come and buy tickets, there's 11 or 10 fights. I think there's 10 now. One might have been scrapped. There's 10 fights on the local undercard from Lou Neglia, who runs Ring of Combat in the area. And if anybody's familiar with the New Jersey, New York tri-state area,
yeah.
Lou Neglia puts on fantastic shows. You know, Chris Weidman, John Vellante, all the guys from this area, from the Long Island, New York area, have come through Ring of Combat. So he's putting on a good kickboxing show. He's a former kickboxing champion himself. So for the ticket, I don't think you're getting better than your money for this card.
Yeah.
It's a really good card for the locals. And on TV, it's not going to be bad either. You're going to get Simon Marquez. You're going to get Rico Vero.
Yeah. Damn, that was good, man.
Yeah. Well, you might promo. Think I do this for a living.
Yeah. Great promo, man.
So all the fights are, what's going to be on Fight Pass and what's going to be on TV? What fights are which?
So the way Glory breaks it down, and sometimes, you know, people can get confused about this. There's a card called Glory Super Fight Series.
Yeah. Right.
And every time, that portion is on UFC Fight Pass. So what you're getting is 5 fights, no tournament structure. It's just going to be 5 super fight matchups done. And typically, they try to have a title fight on the headline event of Super Fight Series. In this case, it's going to be that Simon Marquez fight.
Yeah.
Then you switch over to ESPN, typically ESPN3, but for this event, we're live on ESPN2 at 11 p.m.
Okay.
Eastern. Oh, nice. So prime West Coast, we're on at 8 p.m. West Coast, and it's going to be that 5-fight card that includes the first two tournament fights, then a super fight, and then the final of that tournament, because it's a, you know, 4-man tournament, so they have the final of that, and then Rico Verhoeven.
Oh, nice. And speaking of Simon Marquez, he's obviously a Jamaican Canadian. Is Glory gonna, you know, hit the Canadian market and promote Simon?
Yeah, people have been asking us for a long time, and nobody more than guess who? Like the Canadian fighters. They want the fights in their backyard.
Mm-hmm.
Gabriel Varga asks us every time. Simon Marquez asks us every time. Former champion, now commentator Joe Valtellini, he wants the fight in Canada. So. There's issues with the regulation. Kickboxing is not regulated the same way there that it is here. So unfortunately, I think it's going to be a bit of a longer term thing. But make no mistake about it, Glory is trying to open that up, as well as some other things, man. Glory has some incredible stuff planned for this year and next. You know, getting into the Latin American market, getting into advanced in the Asian market. There's a lot of stuff that Glory is trying to get into. But Canada is one of the first things that Glory is trying to get accomplished. So many good Canadian fighters and champions. Gabriel Varga and Simon Marquez are current reigning champions, and they're both Canadian, as well as guys like Robert Thomas, up-and-comers from Canada. They're really trying to get it done. There's, you know, it's been, you know, a bit tougher than in, you know, getting kickboxing regulated here. MMA was harder to get regulated here in the U.S.
Yeah.
Kickboxing's been legal here for a long, long time. We had an event in New York back in 2012, so... You know, it's a regulation thing, but we're trying to get it done. I know Glory is.
And you have Morwinalo, who's also Canadian.
He is the Canadian, the hardest working man in the business.
Yeah, right.
You guys are obviously looking to go global. Is a priority just right now the U.S. trying to get that, you know, established in the U.S. No.
So there's two parallel tracks right here.
Yeah.
Getting kickboxing established in the U.S. and, you know, through our partners with UFC Fight Pass and with ESPN, we're trying to you know, get a more regular schedule, put on an event every month, get in front of people that, you know, U.S. fans can, bless you, that U.S. fans can get familiar with it. As well, you know, the shows in Europe do fantastic. Yeah. Obviously, that's the home base. That's where Dutch kickboxing lives, and that's where some of our champions are from. So, you know, guys like Rico Verhoeven and Nicky Holskin do bonkers over there. So we're trying to build up both those markets and at the same time expand. There is a, you know, there is a hunger for combat sports in Asia right now that's not being tapped in the way that it could be. You know, there's other organizations trying to expand there. You know, UFC is trying to go there. So Glory is trying to expand into that market as well as Latin America. We can't forget about Latin America. We've got some great, you know, Brazilian talent. We've got some great Mexican talent. And we're trying to, you know, in addition to, you know, keeping the home base in Europe and in the U.S., we're trying to grow that out. And, you know, Glory has over 200 territories worldwide. And I think, you know, don't quote me on this, but I think it may be the most visible combat sport in terms of territories that, you know, it's available. Yeah. UFC is up there, but I think Glory might have them edged out a little bit in terms of content is shown on televisions in over 200 territories that is Glory Kickboxing, whether it be an older event, whether it be a live event. So it has a huge global presence, and we find that, you know, Asia and Latin America, as well as, you know, the European and the U.S. markets are really craving for it. So, man, we're trying to take this thing worldwide, but there has to be an effort to grow it here in the States. People are still, you know, trying to kind of coming around to it. For boxing fans, it's a little too different. For MMA fans, it may not have that, you know, that ruthlessness. Mm-hmm. When somebody goes down, they don't follow them to the ground. They let them stand back up like in boxing. Mm-hmm. So it kind of falls in between. But if you ever watch a Glory event, I can assure you, you'll be a fan. I said that to everybody, and everybody that watches it and takes my word for it becomes a fan instantly. Nobody strikes more. Nobody strikes faster. You never get that period where guys are kind of just dancing around each other that you might get in boxing from a defensive fighter, or you might get from MMA when they're kind of stalling out or taking it to the ground. It is the fastest, the highest knockout rate. So if you can get over the idea of seeing the guys in the big gloves and checking kicks, It is something to behold. And guys like Rico Verhoeven and Simon Marcus take it to that next level.
Yeah. Great promo again, man.
Yeah.
Any shows in the SoCal area? Do you know of?
So I don't think in the next few months they're gonna be anywhere. I think we're moving out west again for the next US event in October. We might have more info on that coming in the next week or the next week after that. To go somewhere out west. I'm not sure if it's going to be SoCal, but we're trying to get back out west because we know that kickboxing is a really strong market out in California for sure.
Yeah. A lot of it's, I think, just developing stars. I mean, I think a lot of the guys like Rico and Marcus and Nicky Holskin, they're becoming regular names that you even hear in the MMA scene.
Absolutely.
That's like a priority for Glory to develop stars. I think that's one of the biggest things to build it in the U.S. is just to build out those names, that recognition.
Yeah, the guys, you know, the one person that went a long way toward doing that was Alistair Overeem. When Alistair Overeem won the K-1 Grand Prix as an MMA fighter and, you know, who was a visible name, it kind of gave a window into that kickboxing world that people hadn't quite seen yet who were strictly MMA fans. Yeah. And I think that now Glory is giving some of those guys a platform that people are seeing that there are these stars, you know, like the names we mentioned, like Rico Verhoeven. Rico is very, you know, well-known in the Netherlands. Nicky is very well-known in the Netherlands. But now some of the U.S. fans are coming around to them and seeing really, truly how talented these guys are as strikers. You know, we see people gushing over the four strike combination Cowboy Cerrone had. We finished Rick Story.
Yeah.
Absolutely fantastic combination. Brandon Gibson and the team at Jackson Winklejohn are incredible. But if you're watching Glory, that type of thing for the European guys is kind of they'll be doing that every round, throwing those combinations like that.
You see that on a regular basis.
That level of MMA striking is not at the level of, you know, kickboxers at this highest level. So if that type of thing is in it for you, and you see that Cowboy Cerrone combination and you think it's beautiful, I encourage you to check out some high-level Muay Thai, some high-level kickboxing, and you will see stuff like that at the highest level. You will see those kind of combinations where guys are putting together two or three hand strikes, a kick on the end of it, finishing with a low kick. You don't really see that in MMA. Maybe at the highest level, you see a guy like a Cerrone, who's incredible. You see a guy like an Aldo. But outside of those guys, you're not really seeing the level of striking that you might from high-level kickboxing.
Yeah, right. Now, switching over to mixed martial arts, you have Invicta 19th, also this month, with the debut of Tiffany Timebomb. Talk to us about that card and what fans could expect from Invicta 19.
First of all, how good is that segue, right? Yeah, we're talking right? about high-level strikers in MMA. Now Tiffany is coming over to the MMA world while, you know, still fighting for glory. She's part of that tournament I was mentioning before. Yeah. Not for this card, but she will be on a future card because she already fought back in L.A. Yeah. I mean, Tiffany's debut is going to be, you know, big, big time. Based on just, you know, the media that people have been talking about it, people are interested in this fight. People want to see if Tiffany has been working on her takedown defense because, you know, I don't think anybody's going to want to stand with her. Let's be real. She's lethal. And with 4-ounce gloves, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough if you want to stand with her. So it really comes down to, can she stop that takedown? And that's going to be the ultimate question. If she can reasonably stop that takedown, I think she's going to be very tough to beat. Standing on your feet with Tiffany is going to be rough. She comes from what I was talking about with, you know, putting together combinations that MMA fighters may not be used to. At the same time, we have to see how big her, you know, how far her game has come, how much she's evolved. I know she's training her grappling every single day out in Bali. And, you know, come September 23rd, we're going to see, you know, if that hard work paid off. I have a feeling that, you know, people are going to be surprised by how well-rounded her game is and how far she's come. But you never know. It's like 4-ounce gloves. We saw this with Joe Schilling. Highest level of kickboxing that you can achieve. Joe Schilling is an absolutely top elite level kickboxer. But in MMA, a guy like Isaki Kato with 4-ounce gloves, who, you know, Joe is used to covering up in a certain way with those bigger gloves. When you get hit with those 4-ounce gloves, it's different. And even Rico, when Rico came into his first MMA fight, that guy was popping him in a way that could potentially be scary for him down the line. It's not the same thing, these guys coming into MMA. So the same way, if you throw an MMA fighter into a kickboxing ring, it's a different sport. They not have the experience necessary. These kickboxers that are transitioning, and Muay Thai fighters like Tiffany that are transitioning to MMA, there's going to be growing pains, and it's going to be, you know, some people come in and ace it with flying colors. Holly Holm, she never really suffered that kind of, you know, jitter when she came over from the boxing world. She mixed in some kicks fantastically, and she looked like a finished product in terms of being able to at least, you know, get up from positions and stop the takedowns. Some people have suffered when they came over to MMA. A guy like Melvin Manhoff has done it for years in both sports. Yeah. So, you know, we get all kinds of different things. It'll be interesting to see what Tiffany looks like when she comes into the MMA cage for the first time.
Like, it's just a style thing, because there's certain things you have to think about and then there's certain things you don't have to think about. And some of the guys have done it pretty flawlessly going back and forth. Do you feel like Tiffany's going into MMA and she's going to dabble in both? Rico's obviously going to dabble in both. Do you think that's what these stars in kickboxing need to do? They need to go to these MMA fan base and to get them to cross over? Is that what they need to do or not?
I think, you know, we can't be obtuse here. We can't pretend that kickboxing in this country is at the level that MMA is. It's simply not. MMA is the bigger sport right now. So it's good for their exposure to get into both.
And
now, at the end of the day, I think that, you know, these people grew up as kickboxers. Rico Verhoeven is a kickboxer.
Yeah.
Tiffany Vanzos is a Muay Thai fighter. They grew up this way, and it will always be in them, and that will be their style. They're never going to, you know, there's people who have done the transition successfully. Alistair Overeem is a shining example of a guy who did kickboxing and now is at the pinnacle of MMA. This weekend, in less than a week, he's going to be fighting for the UFC title.
Yeah, Alistair
it's
Overeem.
Crazy. And, you know, it's good for the exposure, but I think that, you know, somebody like Tiffany, who is going to be dabbling in both simultaneously, she's worked out a schedule with Invicta and she's worked out a schedule with Glory where she's going to be doing both and keeping her skills sharp in both areas. I think that's the best way to do it if you want to dabble in both. And then there may be opportunities to commit to one or the other. But I think, you know, keeping your tool sharp in kickboxing is something that might be overlooked. You might think that somebody going full time to MMA would be a smart move, but potentially that might not be. You might be jumping into waters that you're not quite ready for. I think that you have to keep your bread and butter honed. A lot of times with wrestlers who, you know, they don't work the wrestling because they're so good. I don't need to work my takedown defense. And then they end up getting taken down and they try and turn into a striker. You have to keep your tools sharp. And I think Tiffany and Rico are good examples of doing that.
Yeah.
And do you think if then Invicta's going to push Tiffany to be that poster girl for Invicta?
I mean, she has all the tools. I mean, she has all the tools. But they've got some great champions right now. I mean, Angela Hill is another person who came from a striking background exclusively, you know, fighting Muay Thai, and now she's the champion. And she's looked fantastic since coming to Invicta. Mm-hmm. She has looked absolutely incredible. Livia Souza, I think, you know, maybe is a little small for the 115 division.
Yeah.
But she's been a buzzsaw. She's been destroying everybody.
Yeah.
She is no joke. And Angela Hill made it look relatively easy. Let's be real. Like, it was a good fight, but Angela Hill looked super, super sharp.
Yeah.
I think she could compete with anybody at the UFC's 115. I think she'll, you know, she's going to be a stalwart with Invicta's 115. So, you know, Tiffany's going to have her work cut out. I think it's way too early to say whether, you know, she'll be super successful and be the poster child, or, you know, whether it'll take some time to develop her game. But there's nothing more exciting than this right here, than seeing what she's got and kind of seeing those first steps. And seeing, you know, is she going to take that path that goes straight to superstardom? Is she going to take more of a road that's slower? Is she going to flatten out? Like, this is the most exciting time in somebody's career right now.
Yeah, it's very intriguing, man.
Yeah. Well, one more question about the Glory kickboxing. With Rico fighting Silva this weekend, that fight with Botter, is it for a title? Or is it, let's say something happens with Rico in this fight and he's not overlooking Silva, but, you know, something happens. If he goes into the Botter fight,
absolutely.
Is it a title or no?
Anything could happen. Anderson Silva could be champion by Friday.
Yeah.
Not a question in my mind that Anderson Silva is a dangerous fighter and could be a champion by Friday. It's not a title fight with Botter. That fight is Rico versus Botter, not a title fight. So it's independent of this fight with Silva. Glory would never book Rico in a title fight against Botter if Anderson Silva can be champion. Nobody is overlooking Anderson Silva here. That fight is completely separate.
Yeah.
These two fighters have bad blood and wanted to fight each other, and that's why that fight was made. And it's a huge fight. Botter wouldn't have come out of his retirement to fight anybody else.
He
wanted Rico, and Rico wanted him. So that's why that fight had to be made, but not a title fight, completely independent of this fight with Anderson Silva. That said, Rico Verhoeven is treating that fight like a title fight, so he's going to fight Silva. Should he win there, you know, he's going to take his preparation the exact same way if Badr Hari was coming for his title. He's not going to take his foot off the gas in any way.
Is
not for a title.
It's not for a title. How was it getting Badr to sign on to the fight? Because I know he's been out of the game for a little while. He's obviously had some trouble outside of the ring. Was it difficult pinning him down? Do you know of any of that?
Yeah, I mean, I do know some of that. And it's going to be difficult because this was the only fight that the two guys wanted, so it had to be right. And Rico was in negotiations for his contract. I don't know if you saw the news, but he at the time had been entering free agency.
Yeah.
So it's hard to, you know, get two guys in these different points in their career. It's not like, you know, Botter is in the division and chasing Rico, and, you know, it's a clear matchup for the next fight. It's difficult dealing with big personalities that are used to commanding headline money. Rico Verhoeven is the best heavyweight in the world right now. Badr Hari has been a heavyweight stalwart for the longest time, the biggest name possibly in heavyweight kickboxing. So, you know, it's very difficult to put a fight like that together. You can imagine, like, the UFC tries to put the biggest fights together. We never got GSP and Anderson.
Yeah.
We never got some of those fights between some of the, you know, the best fighters in their prime that we wanted. And now we're getting this opportunity.
Yeah, we're good.
People think
Badr
Hari is significantly older than he is. And the same thing that I was talking about with Jason Willett. Badr Hari is 31 years old.
That's crazy.
He's still
been
in his prime right now.
Yeah, that's crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Badr Hari is 31. Rico is, I want to say, 28, 29. We're getting these guys at their peaks, and that type of thing could be difficult to negotiate. But Glory, I think, is the only organization that could have gotten it done. There's nobody else out there that has the clout, that has the ability to say, hey, we're going to promote this fight as the biggest thing in the world, and you know, with the exposure that it deserves. But Glory was able to put it together, and I think the fans are excited. I think, you know, everybody who knows enough about this story, and we'll be telling more of that in the lead up to December, everybody who knows about this story realizes how big this fight truly is.
Are you guys going to get Saki at all, Gokhan?
So I don't know anything about the contract status of Saki. I know, you know, we had originally booked him to fight in early 2016. I don't think he was quite ready in terms of his preparation. I think he's still kind of getting into shape.
Because he's my guy, man. I love Saki.
Look, we all love Gokhan Saki. He's another name from that tournament that Alistair Overeem won that he was unfortunately hurt. But if he wasn't hurt, many people think he was the odds-on favorite to win that tournament.
He was fighting with one arm.
He was fighting with one arm. Yeah. And, you know, we would love to have Saki back in glory. The light heavyweight division is really strong right now. It'd be great to have a guy like Saki back. Remember, he's not up at heavyweight anymore. So, you know, now let's say come December, Rico and Bader goes down and all of a sudden Saki is looking for the biggest possible fight. He could be jumping right back into that mix. He has a big enough name for that. But as of right now, I don't know anything about the return of Gokhan Saki. Last I heard, you know, he was still getting prepped to come back. So we'll see where it shakes out. He may be back, you know, early next year. Who knows?
Yeah, speaking of the glory heavyweight division, Chi Lewis-Parry, another heavyweight that'll be fighting on this card. That's going to be a guest on today's episode. I'll talk about him and his placement in the heavyweight division.
The funny thing is, I don't need to talk about Chi Lewis-Parry because he's going to do all the talking himself.
Right?
The man, nobody cuts a promo, nobody sells himself up, and nobody hypes himself up better than Chi. But I will say this, Chi is a freak athlete. The guy comes from a professional basketball background. Like, you know, he is an elite athlete. He tried out for the Lakers. Yeah. He's a 6'9" specimen. Truly one of the highest caliber athletes I've ever been around. Typically, you know, fighters are fighters and basketball players are basketball players and hockey players are hockey players. He's just an elite physical specimen. And I'd put in that category? Simon Marcus. That guy is an absolute freak. That guy is an absolute freak in terms of conditioning. And I wouldn't be, if you told me Simon Marcus could jump 10 feet, I wouldn't be surprised. And Chi Lewis-Parry is that same kind of guy. But the difference between Simon and Chi, I think, is Simon's a little more quiet. He's very reserved. He's very humble. He lets his fighting do the talking. Chi is going to come in there and knock you out, and then he's going to stand over you and talk shit. Chi is a showman. I'll tell you this. In the back, Chi will shake your hand and say, good job, buddy. He's a class act. But he is, when it comes fight time, in the lead up to a fight, Chi will sell a promo, and he will make you feel that there is nobody he wants to take their head off more. And guess what? He doesn't want to take anybody's head off more than the person that's right in front of him. We saw every time he steps in the ring, he's throwing heat, and he's also delivering a good show. He says he's not a fighter; he's a showman, and nobody exemplifies that more than Chi.
And Chi Lewis-Parry also tried out for NXT. I think Triple H brought him in. And he tried out. That's kind of crazy.
Doesn't surprise me. Yeah. He's a freak. He's an absolute freak.
Yeah.
He unfortunately, there was bad blood with him and Xavier Vigne. Unfortunately, Vigne's out of the fight.
Yeah.
And we've got McDonald stepping in on short notice. But I think it's going to be a fantastic matchup. Yeah. McDonald's a veteran, been around the MMA and the striking scene for a long time. I think it's going to be a great matchup. But, if you never tuned in for a Chi Lewis-Parry fight, strap in and tune in.
Yeah,
it's going to be good. You can bet your butt he's going to be calling out Rico Verhoeven after he wins.
Yeah. What was the injury with Vigne?
I don't think it was an injury. Vigne just what was there. I think maybe he had another fight booked and was busy preparing for that. Thought he could get a fight in and didn't schedule it right. Something like that.
Yeah.
But I don't think he's injured. I think it was just a scheduling thing.
Okay.
Now he had something else on the books and he couldn't make it. He thought he could get this in, get the camp in, and then go. And it just didn't work out that way.
Okay. If we go back to the Invicta card, because I know for those who don't know, you handle both PR for both Glory and Invicta. The Invicta card is going to be awesome. You got the two title fights on there. You got Ayaka Hamasaki defending her atomweight title, and you have Jennifer Maya, her first title defense in the flyweight title against Jinyu Frey, and you got Roxanne Modafferi as competitors. Man.
Tiffany debuting.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
What do you make of the two title fights?
Oh, I love these two title fights. First of all, the fight between Jennifer Maya and Vanessa Porto for that interim title was one of the best fights
awesome,
of the year.
Yeah,
men's,
yeah,
women's,
yeah.
Boxing, kickboxing, MMA. One of the best fights. One of the events. I was like heart and grit, and that was incredible. It's going to be hard to top that performance. And then in comes Roxanne Modafferi, who since returning to Invicta has looked absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if you look back at some of the wins she's had, Those names are super impressive. It's not been a cakewalk for her to get to this title shot. So I love that fight. Jinyu Fry, another one of these don't look at her Instagram if you ever have any shame about your ab area, because she's chiseled from stone. She is absolutely a freak in terms of the genetics and how hard she works to keep her body in shape. I think she has a PhD in like astrophysics or something like that. Yeah. She has some kind of crazy degree, PhD. She's a sharp person, but also a sharp fighter, a finisher, huge pop in her hands. You know, she went super viral for one of her knockouts before she came into the Invicta atomweight division. At 105, you don't really see pop a lot of times. She's got some true power in her hands. And Hamasaki, nobody's touched her. Nobody's touched her in a long time. So we'll see if Jin is the person to do that. It's not going to be an issue of conditioning. Both of them are going to be able to go five hard rounds if need be. But I think we're looking at two finishers. That's what I really think is like it's going to come down to can Jin get off a clean shot? Can Hamasaki potentially get it to the ground? We're looking at two fighters who come to finish. I think that's going to be a really interesting fight. And you don't often see finishes at 105, but I think here we're gonna see that. These two are coming to finish it. No mistake about it. So those two title fights are amazing. As you said, we've got some incredible fights on the rest of the card. I'm stoked. I think this is one of the best cards that Invicta's put on.
Yeah.
I'm really excited about it.
Yeah, it's probably going to be in Kansas City, not in L.A., man. I'm kind of bummed out about that. But before we go, Eric, I know you went to the NXT in Brooklyn for the takeover.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, man. That was an awesome show. Probably the best show of the weekend. Kano, it was busy. I think on Friday was a Evolve show. Then Saturday had NXT with US 202. And then I think you had the Super J Cup on Saturday as well. Then obviously Sunday was SummerSlam. I'll talk about NXT and your experience there and your heel turn on the MMA hour.
So first of all, I went to Brooklyn last year, and I think that was like the best wrestling show I've ever seen. Yeah. Like live on TV. I don't watch much wrestling on TV these days. I try to get out to the live shows because after I went to that Brooklyn event, my mind was blown. So last year's NXT in Brooklyn was like one of the best things I've ever seen. You know, across sporting events, across MMA, kickboxing. Jiu-Jitsu. I've done PR, and I've been to every kind of sporting event there is. That one was something special last year. This year was also good. Not as good as last year, but probably you're right that it was the best card of the weekend. It was incredible. Man, Nakamura, there's something about that guy.
Nakamura is awesome, man. His charisma.
He's got the showmanship. He's got the charisma. He's a complete package. I'm sure he'll end up, you know, in the big show sometime soon.
Yeah.
I just think he's been down there too short. Maybe they want to, you know, get him ready for American TV a little bit more. But that guy is a showman.
Yeah. They had
the classical violin in house there.
Yeah.
That guy Bobby Roode, I wasn't familiar with him coming in. People were getting excited around me when his music hit.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, all right, I'm into this. Let's see what he's got. And that was super fun. I think is their name the Revival?
Yeah,
Chad Dawson.
That was the best match of the night, I think.
That was the match of the night. Those two can go.
Yeah.
And they were the heels, and everybody was rooting for the other dudes.
Yeah.
The Revival was super awesome. They were fun. Those are my guys.
Bailey's a good match too, man.
Which one?
Bailey.
Bailey was awesome.
Yeah.
Bailey was incredible. I had a feeling after she dropped the match that she was going to end up in WWE, the big show, the next little stretch.
Yeah.
Because I remember NXT last year, everybody but her went up.
Yeah.
Charlotte and Becky Lynch and Sasha and Bailey last year was. Man, I don't even know.
Unbelievable.
But I knew that, you know, they had went up. They were hugging in the ring. I could tell that something was going on there. And I hadn't even been, you know, following that closely. I knew that something was happening there. And then it would end up for her. But like top to bottom, those shows, those NXT shows, I think are like the best bargain you're gonna get. You're not paying that much, and you're sitting super close to some of the best wrestlers in the world. I don't know how long NXT is going to be able to have the top level talent that are kind of like more advanced. Like a guy like Bobby Roode, at some point NXT may have to start sending these guys up sooner. And have them in the big show right away. But for now, right now, NXT is the best thing going, and if you can get out to one of those shows, it is something special.
And talk about your heel turn, man.
So my heel turn. So I'm just, you know what it is, and I'm sure you guys get this too. I'm so sick of these people just eating up. You know, it happens with Helwani. This is what it is. Let me tell you exactly what it is. Hold on. Let me tell you exactly what it is.
He's instigated, man.
Helwani will go out there and say, "Oh, New York Rick is an MMA hipster," just because I don't agree with his cupcake. Everybody should be best friends. Everybody should be singing Kumbaya. Yeah. Oh, this is the best sport in the world. These guys should be best friends. Everything is hunky-dory Kumbaya with Ariel. And when I disagree with it, he says, "Oh, you're just trying to disagree with me." And the people eat it up. The people say, "Oh, you're hipster, Rick. You just want to have a contrarian opinion." Guess what? I speak truths exclusively. I don't speak anything I don't mean. And if anybody knows me personally, you guys have met me, I will shoot you straight. If you ask me for something and I can't do it, I'll tell you I can't do it. If I can do it, I'll do it for you. I only shoot straight. And the fans out there need to get off my case. If I disagree with Ariel, it's because I disagree with Ariel, and they need to accept that. But you know what? I don't care. I don't care if they agree or disagree with me, as long as they're paying attention. And guess what? They tell me, "Oh, I hate you, Rick. I can't believe it." Guess what? They're still tuning in. And if you're going to tune in, I don't care if you agree or disagree with me. You're still watching.
That's right, keep watching.
Keep putting money in my pocket and keep watching the show.
Just say, "Worship me, worship me."
Gloria. I'm going to start my theme music. I'm going to get the Bobby Roode music.
Yeah. Now, tomorrow when Eric asks you, "How are you?" tell him that you're on the show.
No show tomorrow. Tuesday for the holiday. Yeah,
yeah. On Tuesday when he asks you, "How are you?" tell him about the show and tell him to stop dunking me, man. He promised me at 1:99 he's going to be on the show, and I emailed him and nothing, so... Back me up, brother.
I will tell him to stop ducking both of you. I will tell him. That'll be more ammo for me when the trolls come out. I'll be like, "Look, I don't duck the hard questions. Look at this guy. Look at this guy.
Awesome.
All right, Rick, man, you have a Glory 33 this weekend. Friday, yep. You have Invicta 19 on September 23rd. Oh, we got to have you back on before BJ fights Lamas. I want to get you to talk about that.
That's going to be an emotional time. I don't know.
Right?
I don't know. He's here, man. He's here, like, in the SoCal area.
I think he's in the SoCal area.
He's down the street from us.
I'm a big BJ Penn fan, so I'm like with you on that one.
I think everybody loves BJ Penn. The problem is, man, he was over there at Jackson Winklejohn's. It seemed like that's the team that you want to have around you if you're a guy at BJ Penn's position. If you're a veteran and you need that game plan, he's always around his career known for kind of taking it easy and not pushing himself and not having guys that'll say, "No, BJ, that's not the way to do it. Do it this way, and that'll be how you achieve success." And when he got into his best shape at lightweight, it was because he had his strength and conditioning coach, I'm forgetting his name.
Marinovich
was pushing him super hard, and he wasn't, resting on his laurels, and I feel like he's getting away from that. He needs to go back to Jackson Winklejohn, and he needs that kind of structure rather than kind of floating around like he's been doing. But, I mean, either way, it's right until I die with BJ Penn, so... Even if he comes in and starts on that tippy toes bullshit that he pulled out last time,
I forgot about that one.
I'm in it till the end. He's always my favorite fighter because win or lose, he's gonna take it. He's gonna take it personally. He's gonna take it emotionally. Yeah. There's no other way for him to do it, and he's gonna come in and he's gonna fight. He's never turned down a fight. I'll tell you that. So I'm in it till the end with BJ Penn.
Do you have Mickey Gall or CM Punk this weekend?
Oh, come on, stop it. Mickey Gall is going to... I mean, we had that guy in studio. That guy has got a good head on his shoulders.
He does.
He is looking at his career the perfect way.
Yeah, I agree.
He took a fast track to pay-per-view UFC status, but he was going to get here anyway. That kid is super smart. We've yet to see him against an opponent that is going to really push him.
Yeah.
All due credit to Mike Jackson, but that wasn't, somebody who was going to really challenge Mickey Gall. He took it on, short notice, and he's not an MMA fighter. He's more of a striking guy. He looked a little small compared to Mickey. But Mickey was going to get here regardless. Mickey was going to do it the slow way. This way, he did it the fast way. But he's going to be in the UFC for a bit. Sure. He's a good fighter and got a good head on his shoulders. I'm not one of those people who's saying, oh, fuck CM Punk. He got a lottery ticket. That guy doesn't deserve this. He's testing himself at the high. He's stepping into a cage with a guy who's trying to physically hurt him. If you think CM Punk is doing this for exposure, if you think CM Punk doesn't deserve this, you're kidding yourself. The guy is testing himself in a cage with a guy who's trained his whole life to do this. I have nothing but the utmost respect for CM Punk. Mickey Gall has nothing but the utmost respect for CM Punk. And the people who want to see him fail just because he did something else, he did another career before this, those people are jokes. They're jokes. They need to take their time doing something else.
I agree.
That said, I don't think he's going to win, but I'm not one of these people who's rooting for him to fail just because he was a pro wrestler. It's stupid.
It is. Well, Eric, thanks for the glorious interview. And have a great day, man, and we'll talk to you soon, brother.
Always good to speak to you guys. One of the best shows in MMA.
Oh, thanks, I would
love to be back anytime, but I'll work on getting Ariel before that.
All right. Well, thank you, Eric, for your help. You've been a great guy for this. Thank you.
No sweat. I love you guys. Bye.
All right. See
ya. That was Eric Jackman, a.k.a. New York Rick. Again, you can catch him every Monday on the MMA Hour, 10 a.m. Pacific Time and 1 p.m. Eastern Time on the MMAfighting.com's YouTube page.
Yeah. Thank you for New York Rick. Come on. He's a good friend of the show. Hope to have him on soon. He's got a busy schedule ahead of him with Glory and Invicta. And, man, I'm looking forward to that Rico Verhoeven and Bada Hari
fight. Yeah, it's going to be awesome, man.
I wish it was in the States because I think it's in Germany, I think. But,
yeah.
I'm so looking forward to it.
I mean, it's cool that it's being shown live on ESPN, too. Usually just it's not shown live, right?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, next up, in the news, GSP has been the talk of the town. Mm-hmm. He's been doing a lot of interviews. He's been going on UFC Tonight and responding to Dana White's criticism of his motivation for coming back to the UFC, coming back to fighting. And it's also he's also talked about the WME not really being able to be reachable, or you know, they can't get a hold of the people from WME. His agents can't get a hold of them. I think they're scheduled to have a meeting, and that never came about. I feel for the guy. I think he deserves a lot more respect than that. He was one of the highest paid athletes in combat sports at the time. I think Connor and Brock have
surpassed
that a little bit. But he had some huge endorsements with like. With Under Armour and all that stuff. So he might still be one of the most successful ones, I think, outside of maybe Connor. But, man, he's having a lot of issues with Dana. I think their contract negotiations, the makeup, the amount of money that he's losing because of Reebok. Mm-hmm. It's again, that Reebok issue is still there. And we always thought that when GSP comes back, how is he going to deal with that Reebok issue? Because he was making the most out of anybody, man. I don't know. What do you think about his dealings with Dana White? Dana White saying he doesn't think he has the motivation to come back, and GSP saying I'm ready to come back. It's just let's make the deal. And you know, Dana, I don't know. It's very weird how they're handling it.
I mean, I think Dana White is a promoter, so you can't really take what he says seriously. You got to take it with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
Also,
yeah.
I think it's a tactic as far as the good, you know,
negotiations
for GSP.
Yeah.
I mean, GSP is worth a lot of money.
Yeah.
I think by him signing, you know, on the deadline has to be the right deal because he is, you know, sponsored by Under Armour,
yeah.
a rival company to Reebok. And if Dana White disagrees, which I don't think he's going to agree with having that Under Armour logo on his shorts.
I don't know if GSP's asking for that.
Yeah.
Really.
Money-wise,
at least. He's asking for that somewhere to meet him in the middle, somewhere.
I think ever since his departure of GSP, and then the Canadian market has gone down So I think...
Significantly.
I think Dana White needs a GSP. Not only for the Canadian market, but he's also a name. He's also a guy that lost with a title. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, the guys that are fighting for a title now is not really... a true champion, so to speak. I mean, GSP is a undisputed champion so far. So I think that can play, you know, into the fold. But, you know, GSP wants to fight telling Woodley, a fight that he can dominate, and I can see GSP winning very, very, very easily.
Yeah.
As far as the new owners, I don't know. I feel like they look bad in a way ever since, you know, purchasing the UFC. I don't think they're coming out in a good light. What do you think?
It's hard to tell right now because it's so fresh. New, fresh.
Yeah.
We're barely seeing glimpses of these people at the weigh-ins.
Yeah.
I haven't really heard of any fighter really dealing with them.
Yeah.
Not even Connor. Mm-mm. I don't even know if they're in that stage yet to where they're dealing with these fighters, like, personally. And who's going to deal with them, you know? And some of these people, like GSP is represented by this agency. I think GSP actually represented by CAA, which WME and IMG actually, I think, own CAA. So he's actually somewhat already an employee of them.
Yeah.
It's very weird. I don't know what to make of it. I think it's all contract negotiations. I'm wondering, you know, I just want to see GSP get the respect he deserves. I think he's going to eventually get it. I think he's going to get at least most of that money that he's asking for.
Mm-hmm.
And he's one of the biggest stars. You come back, you put GSP against anybody, and it'll be big pay-per-view.
Yeah, especially the MSU card in November.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That'd be huge.
And I think some people are saying, oh, maybe he's not as needed right now just because they have Connor, they have Ronda, they have, you know, some other big names, I guess. But
I don't agree with that at all.
I don't agree with that.
I think they need him in Canada.
Yeah, I think GSP comes back, it's a big deal.
Yeah.
It's a big deal. You know, I would say I'm par with even Ronda coming back because I think you could feel better about GSP actually being able to make a run in the division than Ronda, because there's so many questions with how Ronda's going to come back. I think, you know, GSP is that for sure bet star.
Yeah, and there's a lot of options for GSP.
Yeah.
Tyron is one of them. You know, Nick Diaz, and he called him Nick Diaz. Michael Bisping, even Conor McGregor, a fight that I think that if Conor would have beat Diaz the first match, and they were planning to bring him in.
Yeah.
You know, and have that fight. So there's a lot of options, a lot of money to be made with GSP. It's just a matter of, you know, having the right kind of deal.
Yeah.
But I think that we will see GSP.
I think so, too. Before the end of the year.
Yeah, if not this year, maybe next year for sure. But he'll be coming back.
At least a deal made before the end of the year, I think. Yeah.
But against who knows? But you know, like he's like Connor, there's a lot of options for GSP. Yeah. So that's the right thing.
That'd be good for that end of the year New York card. Because I know they're doing one in November, and then they're doing another one. They're doing at least two this year, right?
Yeah, they're doing one in upstate New York, and then one in MSG. Or maybe the
something like that, right?
Yeah.
Oh, we'll see
what happens.
Next up on the show, we have a very special guest. We have Eddie Bravo, who is, you know, 10th Planet founder. Eddie Bravo Invitational is one of the hottest jiu-jitsu competitions in the game right now.
For sure.
Having some of the top level guys just compete on there. It's such an awesome show. It's on UFC Fight Pass. September 11th, only on UFC Fight Pass, so make sure you subscribe to get it. But here's our interview with Eddie Bravo. All right, so we have Eddie Bravo, founder of 10th Planet Jiu-Jitsu, and Eddie Bravo Invitational, which the 8th one takes place this weekend, this Sunday, on UFC Fight Pass. Tickets on sale now, September 11th, Tower 7 Day. you know what I mean? Eddie, how are you doing, man?
I'm doing good, man. Thank you for having me.
Good, good. Hey, talk about this weekend. It's a big event this weekend. Gordon Ryan, EBI8. How are you feeling?
Feeling great, man. The show is going to be amazing. Gordon Ryan right now is on top of the world. He's the EBI absolute champion, and we haven't had a middleweight tournament yet. This is the first time we're doing 185, and that's his natural weight. So, it's this Sunday, September 11th, at the Orpheum in downtown LA. So if you're anywhere in Southern California, man, it's worth the drive. You can get tickets at ebiofficial.com. We got plenty of $20 seats. Come on out. We got Lucas Rocha, Felipe Fogolin, Eduardo Tellez, Matt Arroyo, Josh Hayden, Kyle Griffin, a lot of killers in this one, man. This one's going to be insane.
Yeah, and Gordon Ryan, I mean, his whole Death Squad team is unbelievable, man. And, you know, talk about the bracket for EBI 8. And talk about as far as like compare that stands out to you and to, you know, to be the favorite to win this whole tournament.
Well, on paper, you got to have Gordon Ryan. I mean, yeah. he just beat Keenan Cornelius, who's arguably pound for pound the best American jiu-jitsu fighter out there, maybe top three in the world. I mean, he was an Abu Dhabi medal. I think he was either silver or bronze the last Abu Dhabi. So Gordon just tapped him in a 90-minute war. So Gordon's got to be by far the favorite in this to take this all. But then you got Eduardo Tellis on the other side of the bracket, who is claiming he's going to win this on defense. He's going to take everyone to overtime and no one's going to be able to tap him. Apparently, his defense is just out of this world. I mean, he is the master of the turtle guard, and anybody who plays turtle guard, there ain't that many people who go to that kind of guard exclusively. But if you do, your back defense and back escapes have got to be insane, because that's basically what you're doing when you're playing turtle guard. Is you're kind of flirting with giving your back up. So. You know, and Eduardo Tellis on the EBI 8 countdown show that's on YouTube, he's saying straight out that he's going to win this on defense, which is going to be crazy. You know, can he survive three rounds? If he does get to the finals and it's him and Gordon, can he survive Gordon's back attacks? That's going to be very, very interesting to see.
Yeah. Are you surprised where he came out straight out and said that he's going to look to do something like that? Because no one's ever really come out saying, like, at least in this system, saying that they're going to try to use play the system to their advantage.
And that's part of the game. Can he pull it off? If he could pull it off, that'll be incredible in its own right. He's not going to get paid anything, but you only get paid. It's a winner take all tournament, so only the winner of the 16-man bracket wins, and he gets paid $5,000 for each match he wins in regulation. So if he wins two in regulation and two in overtime, he gets $10,000.
Wow.
He wins them all in regulation, like Cummins does, and that's $20,000. But if he wins them all in overtime, he gets $0. So it'll be interesting if he can pull it off, but he's not going to make any money. So
they won't benefit him.
Besides the tournament, like you have UFC bantamweight Liz Carmouche, who will be doing the. Like a super fight for the EBIA tournament, and I'm curious to know if those super fights, get paid like a separate paycheck, or
we call those special matches.
Yeah,
Liz is a purple belt, and her opponent Maria Henderson is also a purple belt. Just a little break, a little special match.
Right.
Try to fit the women in between the finals. You know, give the guys who make it into the finals, give them a little chance to rest. This is a rematch, Liz Carmouche versus Maria Henderson. They were just in the finals of the Tap for Taps tournament. It was an all-female tournament, and they got to the finals, and Liz Carmouche won. So this is going to be a rematch, a chance for Maria Henderson to get to redemption. That's a Ben Henderson's wife, FYI. So it should be interesting.
Yeah,
Liz Carmouche has been with 10th Planet now for the last couple of years. So
right. She's
a 10th Planet purple belt, so... That's a little something before the finals.
Yeah, who's kicking off the card this weekend? Is it because the last one you had Eddie Cummings kicking off?
The champion. I like to kick off the shows with I give the champion.
Yeah.
And in this case, since there is no champion, consider Gordon Ryan the number one seed because he's the absolute champion.
Yeah.
So we'll start the show off with him, and it's going to be Gordon Ryan versus Matt Arroyo, former UFC fighter. Right off the to kick off the show, so that's going to be crazy.
Yeah, and right now I think jiu-jitsu is at its highest point as far as popularity goes, and it's all because EBI, EBI and the whole submission movement. How does it feel to be like a pioneer in that movement? Because right now it's on fire, especially here in North America.
I love it. The more submission-only events there are out there, the better. The point system is just so unnatural. People don't fall in love with jiu-jitsu because of the point system. They fall in love with jiu-jitsu because of the jiu-jitsu in their dojo, and nobody's keeping track of points in the dojo. The only time points ever come up is when you compete, and some guys that do jiu-jitsu for 20 years and never compete and never have a point system. So
right.
It's the point system is unnatural. Yeah. So that's where we're getting back to the roots. We're getting back to the foundation of jiu-jitsu, and it's a submission.
Yeah. At least here in North America, it was you and Metamoris for quite a while. Metamoris is gaining some steam with some of their big name fights. But I think in a lot of ways, people felt that they shot themselves in the foot. With kind of closing it off to the public and only doing online streaming. Do you guys actually kept benefited in that, like, immensely? You guys got the Fight Pass deal. I mean, was that like a really good day when they shot themselves in the foot like that for you guys?
You know, I don't want Metamorphs to go under. I want shows to be successful. We need as many shows as possible, you know? EBI is not enough. We need Polaris. We need Metamorphs. We need more shows. Chael's show.
Yeah.
Zapatero. Finishers. As many as possible.
No, Eddie, I was talking to Josh, you know, off record, that it'll be cool to have you possibly maybe compete in a super fight against maybe Hoyce, man. I know, like, you and Hoyce have Hoyce has some heat against you, so do you think that matchup is possible sometime in the future?
I would love to go submission only with Hoyce, but I still haven't started rolling from my back surgery.
That's right.
So I'm not thinking about anything like that.
Yeah.
I gotta see how my body feels when I actually start rolling. We'll see. So feels good though.
How does the process go into getting these cards built? Because you guys put them out pretty quickly. Do you guys start locking down fighters for the next card right away?
Yeah, you gotta do everything in advance.
Yeah,
you know, we try to have a card locked up at least two months prior to the show.
Now, I know you guys like we're supposed to go to Mexico City, but you know, they got canceled and you guys went back to LA. Is there plans to going to Mexico City maybe this year or maybe next?
Oh yeah, we are going to EBI 10 is going to be in Mexico City. It's going to be the bantamweight.
Oh, nice. I really enjoyed the absolute tournament you had. It was really, really exciting. Is there going to be an absolute tournament coming up after maybe the bantamweights?
After the bantamweights, it's going to be probably the 170 division, probably.
Okay.
But we will do absolutes again, probably middle of 2017.
Okay.
Nice, nice. So this card was actually supposed to be all females, and I think they were they. Were they a younger age of like teenage, or what was it? I know, how did that not go through, and what was the dealings with that when this card changed to a middleweight tournament?
Collectively, everyone at the top decided that for the time being, that we're not doing minors right now, too much of a liability. So we're just going to stick with the adults for right now, and hopefully we could bring back Grace and Cora and all those stars later, but for right now we're sticking with grown ass men.
Yeah, was that Fight Pass people like that kind of made that decision along with you guys?
Yes.
Yeah,
because you know, because Grace is a great competitor, man. Like I think Josh and I saw her compete twice, and she's phenomenal.
Yeah, Grace is awesome. She's arguably, she might be the best 14-year-old girl on the planet.
You know, I believe it, man. And speaking of your students, you know, Kira, who fights for Combate Americas, which we see you there all the time, she's going to fight on the next Risen card. Any your thoughts on that fight, and do you see her succeed? Because I think her last fight, she pulled off a twist and pound finish move.
Yeah. The sky's the limit for Kira. She could, I see her as being a force at the top three at the atomweight for a long time. She's young. She works hard. She's got incredible work ethic. Great jiu-jitsu, great wrestling. Her striking keeps improving.
Yeah.
I can see her eventually getting into the UFC when the UFC adds another female weight.
Nice. And the production of you guys' show has, like, I think, gone up each and every event. Do you put a lot of input in that? Is a Fight Pass go talk about, you know, like, what they would like to see for the production? Does Victor Davila kind of have his input? Like, who goes into coming up with some of the production? The look and the feel.
Victor Davila puts it all together, and I just, you know, approve and veto stuff. That's it. But he puts it all together.
Nice. Now, Eddie, were you bummed when Joe Rogan re-signed with the UFC? Because I think for Josh and I, like, really enjoy the Fight Companions on his podcast. Were you kind of bummed that he signed on? Because, I mean, I was kind of bummed because I was hoping he'd be, you know, sticking to the Fight Companions.
We're still going to do them. Fight Companions aren't going away.
Yeah.
So, you know.
You're a fair character, man.
He doesn't do all the UFC shows. He only does the big ones.
Right.
Nice, man. Dude, Eddie, anything else you want to talk about EBI 8 this weekend and what the fans can expect?
Yeah, it's going to be a great show. Again, you can get tickets at EBIofficial.com. Go to YouTube, my YouTube channel, and just search for EBI 8 Countdown Show. That'll we go through all the competitors, and you'll know what the show's about.
But yeah, Eddie, thanks for the time, and Josh and I will be at EBI 8 on September 11th, so we'll see you then, brother.
Thank you, man.
All right.
See you.
All right, take care.
All right, and that was Eddie Bravo, founder of the 10th Planet System. He'll be having his EBI 8 event coming up September 11th.
This Sunday?
This Sunday. Only on UFC Fight Pass from Dilfrim Theater in downtown L.A. Now, we apologize. We couldn't get Eddie Bravo on Skype, so he had to do it by phone, which is cool. But thank you, Eddie, for coming on. Really appreciate it, brother. We'll see you next weekend.
Yeah.
And then up next, we, you know, 203 is coming up pretty, I mean, this Saturday, right?
This Saturday.
Yeah, with Al Silverman challenging Stipe Miocic for the heavyweight title. But a very important fight on that card is obviously...
Even bigger than the main event,
I think, is the debut of CM Punk. They signed him back in, I think, early 2015 or 2014, right?
2014.
Yeah. And he's finally going to make his debut. I think they had a four-part series called The Evolution of Punk.
Which I liked.
You know, kind of documents him, you know, his rise or him training for this fight at US 203. Do you think that this build-up has kind of hurt his...
His debut,
yeah.
I think the layoff wasn't good for him. I mean, 2 years. I mean, it's good and bad, I think.
Yeah.
I think, obviously, watching that documentary series, if it wasn't for that injury, I think it would have been too soon for him to come into the game.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, it felt better.
Yeah, give him a whole other, you know, nine months, almost, at least 10 months. So I think it was better for him to get that shoulder injury, take that extra year to prepare, and now he's going into it. I don't think people are giving him much of a chance. I find it hard to you know see a positive outcome for him in this fight. Even though he has no fighting background whatsoever, I mean, we've seen a lot of throughout the history of mixed martial arts. Pro wrestlers make their way into MMA, and you know, some of them have traditional backgrounds, some of them don't, and it's a toss up. We've seen plenty of guys come and do well, you know. Who's to say he can't? I think people are just judging him because he's the first time in a long time where since Brock that we've had a pro wrestler come in with very little experience. But Brock had that collegiate experience, which gave him some credibility.
CM Punk has
nothing.
He's a wipeout also in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah. But, I mean, I've heard of guys making their transition to MMA and their fighting careers with almost no experience. Like, they would probably train for less than a year and then start fighting.
I think the best example for that is Manny Pacquiao, who came to the UFC 0-0.
Yeah.
And he had all his fights in the UFC brand. So that's kind of rare to see that happen.
People want
to
say, oh, but he went to the Ultimate Fighter, but... You know, still, it's...
He came to Ultimate Fighter with an 0-0
record. 0-0
record,
you know what I mean? So. Like, was it... Yeah, he came from football, you know what I mean? So, that doesn't even really translate that much,
It's the whole pro wrestling thing.
It's the whole pro wrestling thing.
And for those of you guys who believe that they're separate sports or not tied in together, you're crazy.
It's so tied in, and throughout the history of mixed martial arts and just... martial arts in general, they've always been linked to each other.
Yeah, for sure.
They have that grappling aspect to it, yeah, and that striking aspect to it. Even though it's fake, you know,
premeditated.
Yeah. It's predetermined. There's always a lot of guys that go back and forth between both real and fake, I guess.
Yeah. No, I agree. I think CM Punk has lost momentum, you know, due to the layout, but I think this new series, Evolution of Punk, has really helped him as far as getting people excited, yeah, to watch him, because like you see this guy, you know, progress.
It's like the everyman.
Yeah, like you see him coming in and seeing him progress and like in these episodes, I really made me intrigued for this fight. I think he's gonna drop or lose to Mickey Gall, but I do have intrigued to see how it looks now. I think the UFC did a fantastic job, yeah, promoting this fight, and that series is awesome. I think the last episode he met someone from the Make a Wish Foundation.
Yeah,
and went to the comic store.
That was kind of cool.
Yeah, too bad his comic was all in the end when they couldn't see it, but.
I mean, it humanizes the guy, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
he's not like...
There's sympathy, and there's, like, you know, that underdog story.
Yeah, you empathize with the guy, and you see his, like, his underdog story, and him, like, coming from that world, and you see him even reading, like, the YouTube criticism, mm-hmm, the hate. Yeah. I like the series. I thought it was pretty well done. He's obviously a comfortable in front of the camera, too, so...
Yeah. Not just that, but, I mean, like, you can hit him all you want, but the fact that he's has the nads to do this, yeah, and to make that walk and to fight somebody, putting his reputation on the line because people already want to see him lose, it says a lot about his character. So I'm excited to see him fight. I'm intrigued. Yeah. Do I think he's going to win? No, but, I mean, I think, especially here in America, people love that redemption story.
Yeah.
Dog story, so hopefully we get his, you know, if he comes out a winner, or even if he loses the fight, but it was a war, I think that'd be good too as well. So,
I mean, I wouldn't say he could. I mean, a lot of people are not picking him to win.
It's MMA; anything could happen. Yeah,
and I wouldn't put it past the fact that he might win. I know Mickey Gall's already kind of a seasoned, up and coming, you know, prospect.
Yeah,
I mean. Dude, he's been training like every day almost for 2 years. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
a legit gym,
right?
Legit guys.
Yeah, and if you watch that series, like you can see his progression. Like he looks a lot better. He looks comfortable. I think there's word in the mixed martial arts circuit that people are really impressed by him nowadays. So I think the layoff kind of helped him in the long run. That fight happens this Saturday at UFC 203, only on pay-per-view, so check it out. Our final guest is Glory Heavyweight, Chi Lewis-Parry, a good friend of ours. It was a very, very fun interview. In his interview, you can check out his promo work. He cuts a great promo. Here's our interview with Glory Heavyweight, Chi Lewis-Parry. My man.
What's going on? Let me get my headphones because I can't hear that well without them.
Yeah, no problem.
Hold on, let me get these headphones plugged in.
Give us a tour of the Chi Lewis-Parry mansion.
Mansion. This is my little Xbox going on.
Hey.
I've been shooting up zombies. I've been shooting motherfuckers.
Alright, man.
Let's go. Let me get...
This is the training area.
Look at that.
You see, this is where I train sometimes.
Right.
Stay inside and train.
Killing zombies and then training afterwards.
Kill zombies, train. A little bit, have a break, shoot some more zombies and then train.
Alright, man.
Yeah.
That was good to see you. Hey, so the fight's coming up this weekend. It's your Vigny dropped out, man. How disappointed were you about that?
Someone asked me that the other day actually, and they said, Are you fussed? And I was just like, I'm not really bothered because he's not that good.
Yeah.
So it wasn't even like it was like a big deal, you know, it was monumental and I was gonna be so over. I mean, I'm happy to get the you know, scratch that loss off of my record.
Yeah.
Because that's what would have happened. I think word gets around here and he, you know, he's from this area, so he knows how ready I would have been for this fight.
Yeah.
Because he's not even injured. Yeah, I mean, it's not even like he's injured. He just pulled out.
He just pulled out of the fight.
That just says pussy to me. You know. So and he probably likes the fact that he's got one over the guy that's got all the hype right now. So he just thought, you know, I'll get out of this one and I'll go and do some boxing or whatever it is he's doing. I don't know.
He said it was a scheduling conflict, right? Is that what he?
Bullshit. You don't sign a contract and then announce a fight,
yeah,
and then put videos out. I see him running around. It's some little dude that does interviews. He's a real little fanboy. I don't even remember his name, but I saw him at the last Bellator event in Fresno. Not the last one, but the one in Fresno a couple shows back, and he was all a fanboy of me, and then he's hanging out with Vigny and he's all talking shit about me and stuff. And then Vigny's like, yeah, you know, I can't wait to get this working, and then all of a sudden he pulls out. So there's no scheduling conflict. There's a fucking scared conflict.
Yeah,
but you know, he's. Yeah, whatever. It's whatever. It doesn't matter. I don't care. I got a fight. I'm getting to fight at the end of the day, so I'm good.
Did you have to change anything at all as far as, you know, having a new opponent coming up?
No, not really. There wasn't enough time to change anything. Yeah. You know, it's been what, a week or so, just over a week that I've known. So there wasn't time. I mean, what was worked on was worked on.
Mm.
What's done is done.
Right.
And at the end of it all, you know. There's a guy who's stepped in and he's probably going to be more dangerous than Vigny, regardless of his experience, because he's got an opportunity now. You know, there's an opportunity to take down the guy that talks and the guy that's got a little bit of a buzz about him. So it's a chance for him to put himself on the map, and I'm expecting him to come out strong.
Yeah. McDonald, have you heard anything of him? Have you seen any of his fights?
Yeah, I've seen some of his fights. I've seen his MMA fights. I haven't seen any of his kickboxing fights, but I've seen some of his MMA stuff. And do you know what? I love to talk smack about my opponents and all that sort of stuff, but how can you talk smack about somebody who comes in and accepts a fight last minute on such a big show? You know, at least he's turning up to fight. You know, I'll talk shit about Vigny all day long, him and his camp, because they've pulled out of this and they should have. They should have at least. You know what I would have respected more is if Vigny or one of his coaches or whatever just messaged me and said, look, private messaged me and said, look, we've got something else that we want to do or whatever. We're going to pull out of the fight. Just a little bit of respect, you know, just to show. Look, I would have respected that. I wouldn't talk smack or anything like that. But then to do that and then not have a reason.
Yeah.
There's no reason. It's just kind of like, man, fuck. Because that potentially could have cost me a fight. It could have cost me a payday because they might not have found somebody to replace. So, you know, I just think it's a bit of a dick move. You know, just a little bit of respect, message me and say, hey, I'm not an arsehole. Talk to me. You know what I mean? We fought. I'm not your enemy. Like, I don't hate you. Do you know what I mean? It's healthy rivalry. But they didn't do that. They didn't offer me that courtesy. But instead, Vigny puts out a tweet talking shit after he's just pulled out. Man, I'm like, wow, you can't even say nothing now, mate. You can't say nothing.
Now, Chai, you're known for your great promo work. You know, we all know you went straight out for the WWE. So if Vigny's watching right now, man, cut the, like, here's a spotlight to, or the spotlight to cut a great promo against Vigny. So go ahead, man, cut a promo.
Cut a promo for Vigny. Oh man, I'll have to be macho man for Vigny.
Yeah.
I'm too hot to handle and too cold to hold.
Ooh.
Sky is the limit and space is the place. The Chopper Don wants to rain on your face. Motherfucker, run. Run, motherfucker, run.
That's great.
Look, he's probably going to come back and say, yeah, I want to fight. Because at the end of the day, I firmly believe, I put in a good performance. I'll cut my promo. I'll do my best to force a fight with a champ. And then Vigny's going to want to throw his name in the mix. And then, you know, I'll win that belt. And then I won't give him a shot. I say, fuck you. go fight somebody else.
Yeah, yeah.
Just I'll dictate then. Ooh, and I'll be like, no, you had your chance.
Yeah.
He's the one that holds the win over me, but yet he wants to fight me. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, he just wants to be close to me. He knows I smell good. That's what it is.
We had Eric Jackman, who does a PR for Glory and all that.
Yeah.
He talked about how awesome you are as a talker, and you're one of the guys that best promoter for himself. Do you think that will help you get that title shot? Because, you have Rico fighting Silva, and then he's already booked a botter afterwards. Mm-hmm. You can easily probably step in there and fight either, maybe Broderick Silva, maybe Silva fight him, or I think you can make your way in there. Do you think that's a possibility for you?
Absolutely. Yeah. New York Rick is my boy.
He loves you, man.
That's my guy right there.
Yeah.
I need to go hang out. After this fight, I think me and him need to hang out and have a brandy and tear up New Jersey.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
He was playing ball when we talked to him, so.
Yeah.
He was playing basketball.
Oh, yeah?
He's on the same show as you today, so.
Oh, good man. Sharing the show, sharing the ways with my man. I think 100%, I bring the character, the charisma that that Glory needs, or just the sport in general needs for a good title fight, A lot of people complain about, or they talk smack and they say, which you're going to get is just standard stuff. And to be honest, I quite like seeing it. I don't know, maybe I'm a bit of a sadist, but I enjoy seeing the hate. Like, I get some serious hate. But it's not hate. I don't know, I find it comical. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
It's just good to be the
heel. Yeah, but it's just to see how much I'm getting under people's skin.
Yeah.
It's kind of like when I see the hate, I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing. Because
embrace it, brother.
Yeah, it's kind of funny that I think somebody is sitting there in Nova Scotia really irritated by what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And I kind of like that,
Yeah. Are you reading these on YouTube, or where are you reading these at?
Oh man, everywhere. Instagram, the YouTube comments, the Facebook comments. It's ridiculous. But it's funny. It's all good.
Do you respond?
So I encourage jealousy. Just bring it on. Sometimes I respond. Sometimes I do. But then sometimes they start getting racist, and then I'm like, I'm not gonna engage in that now, because I'm encouraging that. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
And then they'll insult other people that maybe I'm in a picture with someone else, and they'll start insulting, and it's not their battle. So I just will cut it, and I'll block them or whatever.
You block them?
Yeah, I unblock them all. Some of them I leave, because then you get good banter going back and forth.
It's fun. We do it too.
With the fans. It's good. It's good fun. Yeah. But to answer the question, I think for sure, I could legitimately contend for the belt. Right. And the talking obviously helps. The promo does help, because as much as I do this for myself, and I do this for the future of my son, this competing game is not easy, and sometimes to stand above the rest, you've got to add something to it and bring something different to the game, a different dynamic.
Yeah.
And I just happen to be a good potty mouth, so so why not use it?
Now you're fighting on a very spectacular card with Simon Marquez and Van Hooren on the same card as you. When you win your fight and you get the opportunity to cut a promo, are you cut a promo against Van Hooven? And if so, I think you should embrace the whole heel persona. And then when you win, call him out, tell him that people worship you. And then if you win that title, I want you to spray paint that belt, brother.
I'll graph it all up.
Yeah, you should, man. I've been waiting for that forever. I want someone to spray paint a belt, but no one does.
Yeah, it'll be like the NWO, back in the day, WCW. 100%. But look, I won't tell you what I'm going to say, because a lot of it is kind of like I'm Jay-Z of the kickboxing world. It's like an organized freestyle.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I kind of have an idea what I'm going to say, but because you don't know what's going to happen,
right?
It becomes a bit of a freestyle. So 100%, I will angle it at Rico. You can't. He's going to be in the back. He's going to be listening to it. He's got no choice. You can't. Yeah. You can't. You know, say that he didn't hear it because of the time difference and all that stuff. So, yeah. I will 100% fire some shots at the champ.
And after
in
the
chopper fashion.
And after the promo, we can kind of mention the MMA Complex somewhere in between.
Oh, for
or
sure.
After.
There's going to be plenty. There's going to be plenty of interview opportunities, all and right. I can throw. I'll throw it in there.
Yeah. All right,
brother.
We last talked to you. It was before UFC 200, and then I don't think we
was it that long ago?
Yeah.
It was like a week or two before.
Maybe
John
two
Jones.
Weeks before. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you know, the whole John Jones thing. You were there with DC. Talk about you were there to witness it all. Talk about like how that was, and even afterwards, and you know that whole experience.
And that's about John Jones too. What happened to him?
Yeah.
Fuck, what has happened to him? I can't believe that he might be coming back. That's just ridiculous.
That's crazy.
Like,
yeah, that is.
They love this guy. I think he must be really good at sexual favors because he is getting second chance after second chance.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe his head game is insane. I don't know. But I think he's a he is kind of like a stud for the sport, isn't he? So,
yeah,
it's whatever. But the experience was rocky. You know, it was up and down, and
what did you say? What did you say to Daniel? Like when that happened?
Do you know what? I didn't say anything because what do you say? You don't want to say that there is no right or wrong thing. It's just kind of like he's very much. In control of his own emotions. He's very good at that. You know, I think the level in which he's competed in his life with the Olympics, etc., and being, you know, Strikeforce champ and the UFC, current UFC champ, he knows how to manage his emotions. And you could see in the embedded, that was pretty much it, how he reacted, you know, where he was frustrated because he wants to put to bed this rivalry with John.
Yeah.
He really wants that. He wants that with a passion, and the fact that we were so close and he got taken away, like it was almost an unreal scenario. It was so unreal. We were actually in the car on the way to the gym to work out for the afternoon, and we got the call, and it was just like, no, you're joking. We just thought it was a prank. Do you know what I mean? Thought it was a joke. There's no way, and it was true. But you know, DC still went to the gym. And still trained as if he was fighting. He was like, you know, the UFC are good at what they do, and they'll get me somebody else.
Yeah.
And sure enough, they did. You know, yeah, that's the that mentality. Yeah. That mentality is second to none. You know.
Right. Yeah. Now, are you in New York or New Jersey right now?
Now.
Yeah.
I'm in Cali,
oh,
baby.
Oh, are you in New York? My bad.
When are you heading out to New York?
I leave
or New
on
Jersey?
Tuesday. No, I leave on Tuesday. Tuesday afternoon.
Yeah.
Now, when you get there, is it just like pretty much relaxing, or do you have like meet obligations to do?
I don't know the schedule yet, but
okay.
I'm sure I'll have stuff to do. You never get to just relax.
Okay.
You get to relax like weigh-in day. So Thursday, I'll get to relax. Like it'll just be weigh-ins, and then that's it.
Yeah.
And then the standard procedure of not sleeping too much the night before,
Oh, man. And
then sleeping all morning. On fight day, like, you know, that standard stuff happens, and we go fight and get this done.
Now, do you talk during the fight or talk trash?
What, to my opponent?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
I love it, man.
Course.
I love it.
There's one thing, like, I won't talk smack like that. I don't want to, you know, like I said, I actually really respect this guy for stepping up
and
taking the fight. So I would not, you know, there's no reason for me to force any trash talk with him before
the
fight.
Yeah, you just want to get someone else.
Unless he approaches me with some bullshit, then I'll have to address it.
No,
but
I meant like during the fight, like when you're actually fighting. That's what I meant.
Oh, yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. But yeah, that's what I say.
Oh, okay.
Before the fight, I won't bother.
Yeah.
But in the fight, I'm gonna, you know.
Yeah.
In the fight, I have to. It's part of what it's part of my character. It's part of my makeup. It's what I enjoy. So. I used to do it playing basketball, and I do it playing video games, and I do it in the gym. So, I'm gonna do it in a fight.
Yeah.
What were you changing? Did you change anything up for this camp? Because I know you're preparing for Vigny. That's not happening anymore. Are you still keeping that going, or is it just like a, you know, just back to basics? Or?
It's the same. I mean, you know, there's never really a specific game plan.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's never that, because you just don't know. You could walk out and get head kicked straight away, and then all of a sudden you're just playing defense.
Yeah, yeah.
You just don't know. Hang on a minute, what happened there? And then you know, it falls out, so you become survival mode. So, I had some things that I wanted to implement against Vigny, but that was more like punishment tactics, you know.
Torture.
But for this guy, I think it's just, you know, respect him and fight hard. That's it. You know, there's nothing. The biggest thing for me, I think, over the last two camps, well, this comeback, the comeback fight, is I didn't want my cardio to be an issue.
Mm-hmm.
So, and when I fought last for Glory against Vigny, my cardio failed me. You know, I fought twice in that night, and my cardio completely failed me. And I watched that fight back, and I think, man, look at me. I'm surviving now. So I just lost a bunch of weight and worked my conditioning, and it worked for me, as you saw against Maurice. So that's it. It's just staying in a different kind of shape. I didn't want to just be a big muscle bully. You know, and now I'm more of an athlete. So
do you attribute that to just being the condition overall, or was it just the fight? Because the fight was very back and forth. It was a fast-paced, aggressive fight. So
yeah, do you know, I was too big, like around my shoulder area, like my shoulders and my neck was too big, and you can see I dropped my hands a lot.
Yeah,
because I was tired. I was really tired. I had a bit of a bad experience with an adrenaline dump after the first fight, because I banged up my left ankle pretty bad in that first fight. DeMario checked the inside leg kick, but he got it right on the ankle joint. And once the fight was over, I went in the back, and you have to sit down, and then you have to warm up again and all that stuff. I just didn't gauge that very well, and I sat down for too long. And my ankle just kind of seized up on me. So it was a case of, in that second fight, I just wanted to get it done.
Yeah.
So I was throwing everything I had. I just thought, you know, I'm going to throw wild punches, just hoping to catch him. And that obviously is never the smartest thing to do. And, you know, you can just see, I just gassed, you know. It's not even like, he never hit me with anything that hurt. He just hit me. That was it. You know, he hit me and I was tired, and you can see in points, I'm just like, I don't even care. Hit me. I don't care.
Yeah.
You know, and I was tired, so I was very excited to get this one back, because he would have seen the me that he should have seen had we fought, you know, the first fight on just a non-tournament basis. But it wasn't meant to be. Yeah. Never mind.
Yeah. Move on.
You know what? It's obvious that you love video games, and right now, you know, games and fighters have been really popular as far as Twitch goes. Do you have a Twitch account? And if so, are you planning to get one? Because I know they actually pay fighters to be on Twitch.
Man, I've heard about this Twitch thing. I'm not on it, I have been been thinking, gee, I need to get on this Twitch thing. Because to be honest, I've been an avid gamer for a long time, and my first sort of online experience was like in 2006 with Call of Duty 2.
Yeah.
That was the first time. Then I became hooked.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my God, online. And, you know, I play games. I'm playing Assassin's Creed, and I was always a Call of Duty fan. And the last year, I've not been on the game at all. Like, I left my console, was over at my friend's house in New Jersey. I just got it back last week. In Virginia. And I just got it back. So I'm now like, Online.
Because Rampage has a Twitch, and he has his team, and you have DJ having his team. So maybe you get your own Twitch and have your own people. You guys can battle it out, man, for bragging rights.
I definitely need to do that, because a lot of the boys at AKA have been playing Rainbow Six, and they've been trying to get me involved. So
I heard that DJ is really good at Street Fighter V, man.
At Street Fighter. Do you know what? I used to be a Street Fighter guy back in the day, but I can't get it on the Xbox controller.
Yeah,
it's just the D-pad on the Xbox isn't quite as smooth as the
look at that, there it is.
Yeah.
Oh shit. This is it's my new girlfriend. This is
it's your needles to the vein, man. That's your needles to the vein.
it is. But you know what? I have to live. I do limit myself, like because it's easy. Time will just fly.
Yeah.
So I've been breaking it up. I'll play for like 30 minutes and then I'll go do something. I'll train something. I'll do some pull-ups or something. I have to break it up because otherwise it will be 6 p.m.
Yeah.
And I got on at 12.
Yeah.
And I'm like, where's the time? Because online it's just constant competition, you know? It's fun.
Hey, have you considered doing any entertainment ventures like movies or commercials? Or you see Connor on, he's on the new Call of Duty. I think he's going to be on there.
He's on the game.
He's on the game.
No way. Yeah. No way.
He's doing that stop motion stuff already for the next one.
That's insane.
Yeah. I can see you in a movie. Wow. I can see you as one of like
the, I know, right?
The evil henchmen.
show me a to boss, the casting and I will be there.
Yeah. Or even in movies, man. I can see you on the next, you know what should be good for you? The next John Wick. I think that'd be good for you.
Oh, well, there you go. I'll ring up Keanu in a minute and see if he's got anything available.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I can see it as one of those.
I tell you what, I want to do is I'd love to do a fight scene. I either want to fight The Rock or Jason Momoa in a movie. One of those two guys, I think, would be silver screen dynamite right there.
There it is, man. There you go. Now, like, you're pretty popular with the ladies, man. I see comments all the time. You know,
Am I?
Oh, yeah, man. Man, they worship you, lucky dog. Anyway, now, are you single or are you taken, my brother?
I'm not taken, no.
Oh, there it is. See, ladies, there it is, man. Dude, how easy it is for a Chi Lewis-Parry to get a woman, man? You can, you know, walk the street, you're 6'9", you're a fighter.
It's usually a conversation starter. Yeah, being big is a conversation starter. And then when I speak, it's like it's another thing. Oh, where are you from? It's like it's all conversation starters.
Yeah.
But I think the biggest thing is how I carry myself. I'm not your stereotypical fighter. I never consider myself a fighter. I will say I'm an athlete, and I don't go around kind of like anything to brag about. It's just like, hey, you know, what do you do? I don't tell people what I do unless they ask me.
Yeah.
You know, I don't go out there and say, I'm a fighter.
There are those guys that we've talked about this before. There are those guys that, like, they like to let it be known that they're a fighter.
not me. Yeah, because it's, you know, it can be perceived as a negative thing, and you know, it's like you're a thug or you're a wannabe tough guy. It's like, nah, it's just what I do, you know.
Yeah. But it's cool, man, because you're a big guy, you're a fighter, you have an accent, so girls kind of wonder where you're from. See, with me, brother, I'm under 5'10". You look at me, I look like a burrito.
I think you're under all the time.
Yeah, I look like a burrito, so like the whole intrigue of where I'm from is out the window because they see me, he's Mexican, and I'm fat, so that sucks, man.
Hey,
so.
Hey, practice your British accent.
Yeah.
Right. Man, if you know anybody that can make heels for guys, that'd be awesome because I need some of that.
Hey, I'm not going to lie to you, though. When I first got here, so maybe 2 months. I've been here like 2 months.
Yeah.
So like 4 months ago. This girl starts talking to me and she hears my accent and she's like, oh, I don't like British people. Oh, that was it. Killed it. I was like, wow. She's like, you're hot, but you're British. Nah, she walked on.
Was she
hot. Yeah. She was a hot chick. I was like, who the fuck do you think you are?
Yeah.
Talking to me like that. Oh my gosh. Sorry, my language.
No, cuss away, man.
I was like, how dare you? No one says no to me. She said no and she kept on walking. So I was like,
with me, they go, oh, you're Mexican. They walk away right away. So
it was just, you know what? You're not going to be everyone's cup of tea, but it was just the way that she did it. It was rude. It was so rude.
Yeah.
I was like, wow, you know, I wouldn't say it's like me walking up. But it's like me walking up to someone and saying, no, I don't like you, you're Chinese.
Yeah.
That's like, it's racism.
Yeah.
It is actually racism.
Yeah.
You know,
I mean, she met some British guy that did it wrong.
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe.
Yeah.
All right, ladies. All right. In the market. Hit them up.
All right, Chi, man. Hey, best of luck this weekend, man. Glory 33. You're looking forward to it, man.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. You know, I'll definitely, let's get back on after.
Yeah. And
we'll start talking.
You know, Chi,
some more smack.
Before you leave, you know, we're in the fans, we can find you and the ladies, you know, and also some of your sponsors as well.
Yeah, for sure. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram. Obviously, Facebook's Chi Lewis-Parry. Twitter is at Real Chopper Chi. Instagram, Chopper_Chi. I don't have the same handles, unfortunately, because somebody, believe it or not, has Chopper Chi.
Oh, you got to find out who that guy is.
On Twitter, they have Chopper Chi. I was are you kidding me? You can't be taken. So I had to be Real Chopper Chi.
Okay, yeah.
He's the phony.
Okay.
Whoever that one is the phony. Yeah, I want to shout out, you know, a big shout out to Tree Crew Industries.
Mm.
Those guys sponsored me for Last Fight, and they helped out massively. Yeah,
awesome.
Daniel Cormier Wrestling, Oak Grove Technologies. I've got a shout out Rubenstein. I've got a shout out Mogul. I've got a shout out AKA. Massive shout out Bob Cook and Dwayne Zinkin. Of course, Rosendo Sanchez and Rudy Cruz.
Yeah,
these guys have been hooking me up with those dynamite hands.
Those,
you know, my boxing fists. and of course, you know, Hayabusa, who support me, and
awesome, yeah.
Dethrone. Hey, watch out, Dethrone Royalty and the Chopper Don are doing work.
Awesome.
So shout out.
You gonna have your own shirt? Are you gonna have your own shirt soon?
Man, I'm gonna have my own shirt.
Look us up, man.
I'll hook you up for sure. Don't worry.
Well,
just send me your sizes.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we look forward to your fight. Like, we look forward to that awesome promo after the fight. You know, mentioning MMA Complex.
Nothing but big fights ahead.
Yeah. And also, you can hire me, and I'll bring ladies to you, man.
Are you gonna bring them through? You're gonna be my pimp.
Yeah. Hire a short Mexican guy, dude.
All right, boys. All right, nice one. Appreciate it. You have a good day.
All right, bye.
All right, and that was Chi Lewis-Parry. Thank you to him for being on the show. Good luck this weekend at Glory 33. It's gonna be an exciting card. You got Ricard Verhoeven. You got Simon Marcus. You got
Zoila Frosto
making her debut. You have obviously Chi Lewis-Parry. We hope to talk to him again soon, and hope you guys enjoyed that interview. Right now, we're just gonna start to wrap up the show. We're gonna get to fight picks. Fight picks is like we have a lot to go over. Okay, so there's EBI 8 this weekend. Gordon Ryan, the middleweights. Make sure you check that out. That's September 11th. UFC Fight Pass. Only on UFC Fight Pass. Make sure you check that out. It's going to be such a good card. We're going to be there in attendance. We're going to bring all the coverage that we can. Make sure you go to the YouTube channel, iTunes, whatever. You're going to bring all the stuff that we can get from EBI. It's going to be an exciting show. We look forward to it every time they come into town.
Yeah, I'm excited for that.
And you also have Titan FC 41 this weekend. That's September 9th, also on Fight Pass. You have RFA 43, Camozzi versus Barnes, that's from Broomfield, Colorado. That's on Access TV. That's September 9th. You have Cage Warriors 78 on UFC Fight Pass. That's on Saturday.
Oof.
And also that Saturday, you have UFC 203, Miocic versus Overeem for the heavyweight title. We're just going to go through pretty much from the main card of UFC 203 and give you our picks for that. So, kicking off the main card, you have Jessica Andrade versus Joanne Calderwood.
It's a good fight, man.
To kick off the main card. That's a good fight to kick off the main card.
Yeah.
Who do you have for this one?
I like Joanne Calderwood in this fight. I think she looked really good against Valerie in the last fight. I was really impressed with her performance. I'm going to pick Joanne.
Yeah. I think I might go with Joanne, too. I like Joanne. I like the way she fights. She looked good against Valerie. Jessica Andrade is no joke, though.
It's a tough fight.
I think it's a pretty even matchup in terms of skill and all around. So I'm going to go with Joanne.
Mm-hmm.
Uriah Faber versus Jimmy Rivera, which is
a great fight, too.
This is a tough fight. Jimmy's like a little tank, man. This is a tough fight for Uriah.
I almost forgot that he's fighting this card, Uriah Faber.
Yeah.
But you know what? I think Uriah Faber is the best bantamweight besides the champion.
Mm-hmm.
I think you beat everybody else, so I'm going to pick your eye favor in this fight.
I'm wondering how long he could keep that up, man.
Yeah. He's getting up there in age, man. He's in his 30s.
Yeah, I think Jimmy Rivera is a big test for him, too, because he's an up-and-comer that is rock solid, man. So I don't know. I'm going to go with... Something tells me Jimmy, but I can't bet against Faber, man. Yeah. I'm going to go with Faber just on experience. I think he's just going to... He's going to probably edge him out in some way.
Yeah.
Mickey Gall and CM Punk. It's finally happening.
Yeah.
CM Punk is here.
My heart... is going for CM Punk, but I think Mickey Gall is going to come out with the victory. But I'm ready for you, CM Punk.
I'm gonna go with CM Punk. I know it's not the popular one. It's probably most likely not the safe money.
Yeah.
But I think after 2 years, coming from professional wrestling, and we've seen plenty of guys do very well coming from professional wrestling. But, you know, I don't think those guys get enough respect. And if you look down the lineage, Sakuraba... There's so many guys that come from that world.
Yeah.
I think after 2 years of training, I think he's going to shock some people. I think he's going to surprise some people. Whether he wins or loses, who knows? But I'm going to go with CM Punk for the victory.
All right.
We'll see how that goes.
Yeah.
It's going to be an exciting one out there, man. I can't wait for that to finally happen.
I know, seriously.
Travis Brown versus Fabricio Werdum in the co-main event.
I think... You know, the former champ, Werdum, I think this is a fight just to get him back to that title shot. I think Travis Brown, since joining Edman, hasn't looked the same. And I can see Werdum stopping Travis Brown.
Yeah. I think the safe money is definitely on for Fabricio Werdum.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously Travis Brown has that puncher's chance.
Yeah.
It's easy. I mean, he's very talented.
Yeah.
But Fabricio is the former champ who I think is probably going to fight for the title next.
Yeah.
Or at least contend for it at some point.
Yeah.
I'm going to go for Fabricio.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a safe money right there. Stipe versus Alistair for the heavyweight title. This is going to be good, man. This is going to be a good fight.
Yeah. Great fight. Tough fight to pick. I'm going to go with the champ, Stipe Miocic. I think his footwork is a lot better than Overeem. I think as long as he avoids the clinch work and those nasty kicks that Overeem throws, I think he has a good chance. He has heavy hands, good footwork. All the ingredients you need to beat one Overeem, so I'm going to pick Stipe.
I'm going to go with Stipe too. I think the reason I'm picking him, I think Alistair throws those one-off shots. I think Stipe is going to, his footwork is just going to allow him to pretty much box him up a little bit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I think he's going to hurt Alistair. I think Alistair's chin is still suspect.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go with Stipe. Just based on footwork skill. The only person I see really handling Stipe, and I know JDS did a pretty good job when JDS was still fighting pretty good.
That was a tough fight for JDS,
too. Yeah, that was a tough fight for JDS, is Kane.
Yeah.
I think Kane still... any one of these guys can knock each other off.
Yeah.
We've seen Alistair take out JDS. Stipe, Alistair, Fabricio's there.
Yeah.
It's gonna be interesting.
I mean, this is why you know that division is the hot potato division for the belt. I think Randy is defending it twice, and that's the record right now.
Yeah.
So it's gonna be a good fight though. Good
I'm
card.
Yeah, it's a good card.
Yeah, good
Saturday
card.
Night. Make sure you check that out. UFC 203. So it's a busy weekend. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday you have fights. UFC Fight Pass, Access TV, pay per view.
Another busy weekend for us, man.
Another busy weekend. So. Thank you to all our guests for being on the show. 1 year, we did it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so looking forward to the next year. Thank you to Eddie Bravo. Thank you to New York Rick. Thank you to Chi Lewis-Parry. Awesome guests that we had on today.
It was fun.
Fun show. Make sure you follow us on social and go to MMAComplex.com.
Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter, MMAComplexJames. JYMZ, you can follow him on Twitter.
Yeah.
MMA Complex Josh.
YouTube channel. Subscribe.
Yeah, subscribe on the YouTube channel. Like it, share it.
Yeah.
Subscribe on all podcast form as well. I want to thank Hollow Rock Gear for sponsoring the show.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and go to hollowrockgear.com. Use the promo code COMPLEX15 to save yourself 50%. Like Josh says, it's going to be a very, very busy weekend.
Yeah.
With UFC 203, EBI 8, which will be there in attendance. So we look out for that. So until then, enjoy the fights. Enjoy your week.